I went to go find one yesterday, but I wasn't able to do what they eat tomorrow.
Oh, that's great. So, I love it.
Actually, I was getting too
easy. I hope it actually is recording. Like, listening to it. Should be good.
I want to thank you all for being here today. I appreciate it, and I'm looking forward to getting to have an interaction with you guys on a regular basis. I'm very appreciative of Abe giving me the chance to be the head coach for the Union Blues. I know things have been difficult. I've been an assistant coach with the Union Blues for some time now. I was even injured at that game at Antietam, but I appreciate what Ambrose did as the head coach, I hope he does well. I know he's going to do well in his future endeavors. But I'm really pleased to be the head coach of the Blues. And I tell you what, this is the biggest team I've ever seen. We're going to be the best team. I know we got this game coming up with the Rebels here soon, but we've they've had our number here recently. But under my coaching staff and the way the guys are going in camp, we've cleaned up camp. We're doing things differently, and I believe that what you're going to see is a different Blue team out on the field, a team that's going to be able to be there to compete. And it's going to be a team that's going to be able to win, and it's going to be a team that's going to be able to put the hurt on any opposing foe that we may come across on the field. I got to say, again, thank you to Abe for allowing me to have his chance to coach the Blues. And at this time, I will be taking questions. Yes, over there.
Coach, Gary Owens, ESPN. Congratulations on the hire. Last year, you went 2-8 for the season. What are your plans for this year?
Well, all I can say about that is may God have mercy on Bobby Lee, because I will have none.
Wow.
That's right. You want to talk about locker room material? Before he even had his first game, Joe Hooker was already saying he was going to whoop up on Bobby Lee, who had done nothing but whoop up on the Union boys for the last several months. There's some locker room material for you.
Next question. Yes, you over there. Yeah, the little guy. Yeah, you. No, the little guy.
Coach. Thank you, Coach. Michael Budniak with Christian Science Monitor. Coach, there are reports from your training camp that you encourage gambling and drinking as well as providing prostitutes. How do you account for these wild rumors?
Well, it's a violent gang, as you know, and of course the guys are going to need some love and, alcohol. And if that's the case, I'll provide it for them.
Your freaking mind!
That's right. To lift up morale, he encouraged gambling and drinking, and he brought a lot of prostitutes with him. So many that there was considered a division of prostitutes. Now, the term hookers, a.k.a. prostitutes, had been well known prior to Joseph Hooker taking command, but it wasn't a really popular term. But when Joe Hooker came in and brought a lot of prostitutes, and they were called, these prostitutes were part of Hooker's brigade, thus then shortened to the word just hookers, which again had been a term that had been known, just wasn't well known. Now we start using hookers all the time. So for the oldest profession in the world, you want to know where they got their popularity in the word hookers? This guy, Joseph Hooker, Fighting Joe, and his hookers' brigades.
So, as you can see, I'm not going to take any more questions, but we are really the best army that is on the battlefield of competition, and I'm going to tell you right now, you can count on Fighting Joe Hooker to be able to kick some Confederate butt. All right, and also, guys, let's learn some Civil War with the Battle of the Wilderness, as well as a little more about Stonewall Jackson and Joseph Hooker.
charge. Charge!
So, with 120,000 men, police 50,000, Joseph Hooker, Biden Joe, is going to be able to put a whooping on Bobby Lee. He knows he's going to do it right outside of the town of Fredericksburg. Now, if you remember, the Union Army just got their butts whipped there at the Battle of Fredericksburg with Burnside just a few months prior. And here, Hooker's going to be like, revenge. Revenge is best served. Joe's a little bit smarter than what Burnside was. He knows he's not going to come across those bridges. Bridges are going to be a bad shape. What he's going to do is instead, as you can see, go around through the woods and over the hills to Grandma's house we go. Around through the woods. And when he's going to come out of the woods, he's going to go hit Bobby Lee, and he's going to hit him in the face. He's going to kick him when he's down, and things are going to be, and the war's going to be over, and there's going to be much celebration. All of the generals are totally stoked about this plan. They think this is the good plan. But as he's coming through the woods, the first line of defense that he sees is Stonewall Jackson. And instead of going on the aggressive attack, in which he has 2-1 numbers, and at some points on the line, 3-1 numbers, he says, oh, I am not going to be a fighter. I know my nickname was Fighting Joe, but no, I'm going to be someone that sits. So on May 1st, 1863, instead of being Fighting Joe Hooker, he's Sitting Joe Hooker. And a clash takes place, but it's not because of him doing it. It's because Lee goes on the
offensive.
So, coming into Stonewall Jackson, Joseph Hooker changes his entire military campaign. One guy makes that much of a difference. It's interesting what one person can do at times. How much of a difference one person, oh, I did that twice, one person can do for a difference. So the end of May 1st comes. Joe Hooker is sitting. Stonewall Jackson goes up to his beloved General Robert E. Lee and says, I got a plan. I got a plan that's gonna work good. And this plan is, here, let me take half the troops, half of them. And what I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna lead the front line. So if Joseph Hooker attacks on May 2nd, you're gonna get your butt whooped because it's gonna be 120,000 to 22,000. That's not good numbers. But we all know that he's not gonna attack. So let me take 28,000, walk around the woods, and hit him on the flank. It's gonna take me all day to do it. I'm gonna get the entire day to do this. But when I hit him, I'm gonna hit his flank so hard, he's gonna have nothing to do but run. And I know that's what he's going to do. So, Robert E. Lee agrees and says, all right, Stonewall, go ahead and you get this done. So, dinner time comes around, and through the woods comes Stonewall Jackson, hitting the 11th Corps of the Union Army held by General Howard. And General Howard commanded mostly recent German immigrants, who a number of them weren't even great at speaking English yet at this point. So when they got hit by Stonewall Jackson, instead of cooking their dinner or fighting back, they ran.
and they ran pretty fast. And then the next group of Union soldiers ran, and it was a complete rout. Instead of Joseph Hooker doing what he should have done and attacked Lee's front, he sat there and waited for Lee to attack. But Lee didn't attack. Lee had Stonewall Jackson attacked on the flank. And so thus it was a complete rout. So with the routing, Stonewall Jackson decided to go venture past the front. He wanted to see how much damage he had already done to this Union lines. So he and several officers get on their horses and ride off to see what was the total damage they had inflicted on the Union Army. It's getting to be nighttime. They see they've done well. Pat on the back. They're riding back now to their own troops, coming through the woods where the Union had been. And as they're approaching their own line, a group of North Carolina boys, on for sure what is coming at them, knowing that simply the Union were there and now there's soldiers coming on horses at them, opened fire. Little did they know, they were opening fire into their own beloved general, Stonewall Jackson. And their marksmanship wasn't, perfect, but it was enough to mortally wound the great Stonewall Jackson. So the South's most beloved general, or one of their most beloved generals, Stonewall Jackson, was shot by his own men, ended up getting his left arm amputated. He didn't die from that initial shot, but 8 days later, he's going to be dead. Now, Robert E. Lee, upon hearing that Stonewall had been wounded, is going to say two major things to realize how important Stonewall Jackson is. One, he's going to wish that he was able to take the place of Stonewall, that he actually would have been the one that had been wounded instead of Stonewall. And he believed it would have been best for his country had that been what had happened. Maybe Bobby E. Lee was right. The other thing Robert E. Lee said was Stonewall may have lost his left arm, but I lost my right arm. And that there indeed is going to be the case for this. With the eventual death of Stonewall Jackson, Robert E. Lee will definitely have lost his right arm. But let's finish the battle. May 3rd comes around, and Robert E. Lee needs somebody to take Stonewall Jackson's brigade. So he goes to his cavalry commander, Jeb Stuart. And Jeb does an amazing job leading. Jeb rallies the troops and says, Jackson is with you. And together they launch another attack on the third day of the Battle of Wilderness at Chancellorsville, in which they thoroughly routed Hooker. Matter of fact, in a chaos on Hooker's headquarters, a mortar shell came hitting him, causing Hooker to give a concussion, and he himself was somewhat taken out of command on that final day. The Battle of the Wilderness at Chancellorsville is a complete Confederate victory, and Hooker is forced to retreat. Upon finding news of the retreat, President Lincoln is known to exclaim, my God, what is our country going to do? This is devastating times for the once again more powerful, mighty Union Blue that is again getting whipped by the Confederates once more.
The History Network wants in on this. We're news too, only news told much, much later.
Wait a minute, is that the ghost of Stonewall Jackson with you?
Yes, it is. And the mighty Minotaur.
I don't know about this, man. Minotaur isn't even history. He's mythology. Hey, let's not downplay the fact that that's the ghost of Stonewall Jackson.
May the Lord anoint this hallowed field of battle.
Now, outside of making a great cameo, the ghost of Stonewall Jackson in the Anchorman franchise, Robert E. Lee did more with Stonewall than he did any other general. And he trusted Stonewall Jackson more than any other general. He split his army against greater sizes only with
Stonewall Jackson, and his whole combat techniques and strategies will drastically change once he loses the beloved general. So let's think of the things that they did together. Shenandoah Valley Campaign, Stonewall Jackson. The 7 days, although not efficient, again, Stonewall Jackson was used in a flanking movement. Battle of Cedar Mountain, we didn't talk about it, but again, Stonewall Jackson being used in a flanking movement. Second Bull Run, once more. And then, of course, Chancellorsville, the one that we just discussed. And then Stonewall Jackson was also used as lines of defenses at Antietam and held strong, and Fredericksburg and held strong. And let's not forget that Stonewall Jackson got his nickname of being a Stonewall from the first Battle of Bull Run, when General B said, "Let us rally around the Virginians there, and there stands, sorry about this, there stands Jackson like a Stonewall, let us rally around them Virginians." So Stonewall Jackson is an amazing military commander that Robert E. Lee will never have that kind of relationship again with any other general. James Longstreet, his old warhorse is going to be the nickname, is going to be his next most loyal kind of commander, but it's not the same relationship. It's not. And you guys have seen head coaches that lose an amazing assistant coach, and it's really, we find out later, it was maybe that offensive coordinator or that defensive coordinator that truly made a team, and once they left, it wasn't the head coach's brilliance, but that coordinator's brilliance. And that's what's going to happen here. James Longstreet is a very formidable general. Does some good stuff with his men. His troops will love him. But he's no Thomas Stonewall Jackson. So we should probably take a moment to just reflect on who Stonewall Jackson is. So since we're talking about one of the South's most finest generals, it makes sense to be on a front porch swing. Thomas Jackson grew up in what would be modern-day West Virginia, but at that point, he was still part of Virginia. West Virginia, as we know from earlier in the class, doesn't split from Virginia until the Civil War erupts. But by the age of 7, Thomas Jackson was an orphan. He had already lost both of his parents. As he continues to grow, he's a struggle for him on academics. But he eventually gets an appointment into West Point, and he is the very last person to get admitted into his class, which is going to be the legendary class of 1846. In that class, the second person that graduated second from that class, George McClellan. Other members of that class were Pickett and A.P. Hill, but A.P. Hill gets sick during her time of schooling, and then will actually have to hold back a year. After the class of 1846 graduates, Thomas Jackson serves with great distinction in the war with Mexico, and then he comes back home to Virginia and becomes an instructor at VMI. There, he has mixed reviews as a teacher, because he teaches two types of classes, one that is physics and engineering, and the other is an artillery class. And if you had Thomas Jackson for artillery, blowing stuff up, that's pretty fun. There's some cool stuff, you know, when you're blowing things up as part of your class.
Ornego's car alarm won't stop going off. I have a solution.
I just watched this!
Considered waxed.
There are city codes!
Stay right there.
Let's go!
What a neighbor.
But as a classroom teacher, Thomas Jackson memorized his book that he would study from, but the class would use, the day before by literally sitting in a corner and memorizing things words for words. And then the next day for his lectures, he would just regurgitate what he had memorized. And he was very, very strict on that memorization. For example, one time he asked his class, "Cadets, what are the three simple machines?"
and one student.
Oh, I know. It's the inclined plane, the lever, and the wheel.
You're wrong, sir. It is the lever, the wheel, and the inclined plane.
Stonewall believed secession was wrong, but he believed federal tyranny was even worse. So he supported the Virginia Commonwealth becoming a part of the Confederacy. And when it opened up, he was still at VMI. And so in his VMI uniform, he marched the cadets that were going to be loyal to the South up to Bull Run, in which they were, of course, engaged in battle. And this is where he gets that nickname from General B, when General B was like, "Look, let us rally around the Virginians. There stands Jackson like a stone wall." Thus, Stonewall Jackson was created. His Shenandoah Valley campaign was so brilliant, in which he had only 8,000 troops and was able to take on forces of 60,000, winning in a series of attacks over and over and over. It's so brilliant that even today, if any of you go to VMI or West Point or the Citadel for a military officer school training, you will study his techniques that were used in 1863. He is a groundbreaking general, innovative and beloved. He had so much respect that when he captured some Union soldiers, the Union general said to his own men, "Gentlemen, we have the honor of being captured by Stonewall Jackson." And when the United States Navy captured the Stonewall Jackson, a Confederate warship, they did one thing that they didn't do with any other Confederate boats that they captured. Anytime the United States Navy captured a Confederate boat, they renamed that Confederate boat. But in tribute and honor of Stonewall Jackson, the CSS Stonewall remained with the name Stonewall. That's how much clout and reputation and prestige that Stonewall Jackson had, even in the Union. Now, when you're brilliant, sometimes you're a little eccentric or and Thomas Jackson is just like that as well. He believed his right arm was heavier than his left arm. So therefore, he believed because his right arm was heavier was because he was pulling extra blood. So often, you would see him with his right arm raised so he could drain the blood out of his right arm. He would often eat standing up because he believed that if you ate sitting down, you were putting undue pressure on your digestive system. He believed he had this list of ailments, as you can see. They were all self-diagnosed, but he believed it. And he would often get mad at his own officers if they were not sitting straight up, because if you're slouched, well, again, you're disrupting your body's functions. When he was shot on May 2nd, he received two bullets into the left arm, forcing that left arm to be amputated, and one into his right hand. And 8 days later, he will die of pneumonia. So that is the true medical ailments that Thomas Jackson is going to have. That list of stuff earlier? Yeah, maybe, maybe not. But again, this guy's slightly different. If you invited Thomas Jackson for dinner, it was often known prior to the war that he would bring his own food with him because, you know, he didn't trust the host. Good friend you are. But he's also a very religious kind of guy. He spent hours daily reading scriptures and going to prayer. He was very active in his church. If you go to his church's records, you can see that he tithed regularly, and it was always the 10%. For Sunday school, he taught, but he didn't teach like kids or, you know, men. No, interesting, he taught Sunday school first for his slaves, and then he opened it up to any other slave that people felt like bringing over for Sunday school. He refused to read the mail on Sundays, as well as the newspapers, because that was the Lord's day. And he also would always be upset once the wars took place with the papers, because the papers didn't give credit to his victories to God, which is what he believed. Instead, the papers gave credit to him. And he's like, that irritated him. He's like, no, God got this victory for us, not me. So the South, they won't recover the loss of Stonewall Jackson. He is truly a beloved general, and Robert E. Lee never fights the same way again. So it is, in my opinion, and I firmly believe this, that with the death of one person, Stonewall Jackson, that the Confederacy will be doomed to lose the war. Robert E. Lee will not trust any other general the same way again. He changes his military plans because of one guy. So, yes, we still have the Battle of Gettysburg, and that is going to be the turning point of the war, and that's only, and you've already read about it. It's in the chapter, so you've read about it, and we're going to talk about that here soon. But, yeah, one guy changes the outcome of this war. All right, so that's it for our notes.
It's the ghost of Stonewall Jackson! Everyone, it's the ghost of Stonewall Jackson! Why do we have to fight? There's so much I could learn from you.
Fellas, I hope you are doing great. I do gotta say, I miss us not being in the classroom, but I hope these are helping you out. As always, if you have any questions or need anything from me, please let me know. Send me a message and I will get back to you. Until then, remain awesome, be nice, and stay safe. All right, guys, I will catch you later. Bye.
Hey, how you doing? This is Ted Lasso. I'm the new head coach of the Tottenham Hotspurs, and I'd like to talk to the Queen, please.
My name's Ted Lasso. I'm new head coach for Tottenham Spurs. Been brought over here to implement my coaching style.
Football is football no matter where you play it. You got grass, you got cleats, and you got helmets with masks on them.
Football in the States is my specialty, but they have a different kind of football over here.
Kick it!
Circle them up, have them put on their pads, and let's start playing for real.
They're wearing their pads, coach.
There's a lot of small similarities.
A team I coach, they're gonna play hard for all four quarters, okay?
Two halves.
What's that?
Two halves.
Okay, halves. We're gonna play hard for two halves. And we're gonna play till there's a winner and there's
or
a loser.
A tie.
What's that?
A tie.
Okay, till there's a winner, a loser, or a tie. You can tie.
If you tried to end a game in a tie in the United States, heck, that might be listed in Revelations as the cause for the apocalypse.
Yeah, do we have any goals this season? Absolutely. We're going to win a lot of games. We're going to get in the playoffs.
No playoffs.
There's no playoffs. Again, my job just got a lot easier. Ties and no playoffs. Why do you even do this?
One of the issues I've had is what tackling was.
There you go, tackle!
What the hell? That's not a tackle. It's just sliding around.
Soccer tackle, sir.
All right there, Gary. That's how you tackle.
To prepare for this job, you know, read a lot of books, watch a lot of game films. But to be honest with you, the best way to learn how to play this game is to play this game.
The square, goal?
Circle. Circle's goal. See, I got you a little do-si-do. You don't know what to do.
There you go. Good stop. Okay.
Game over.
Yeah, it's over for now. 15-0, huh? We're going to go in a rematch.
Yeah, they do things a little bit differently. Part of me finds some of the things they do a little silly.
Pass it in. Well, they keep passing it backwards. What's going on here?
It's nice to be able to go backwards and forwards and not have some ref make a big deal about it.
Will you explain to me how that was offside? No, I'm asking you. Seriously, explain offside to me. It made no sense.
Well, the first thing I had to do when getting this job was learn about the competition. We came up with a flashcard system in order for me to make American comparisons to English teams. All I had to do was link what I don't know to what I do know.
Manchester United. Super rich. Everybody either loves them or hates them.
Dallas Cowboys.
Liverpool. Used to be great. Haven't won a title in a really long time.
Also Dallas Cowboys.
Cardiff City, dragons on the crest.
What's that hot girl's name from Game of Thrones?
Khaleesi.
Khaleesi.
Manchester City.
Jennifer Lawrence.
West Ham United.
Pickup trucks.
Because of that training that I did, I guarantee that we're going to beat the Cowboys, and Jennifer Lawrence. Has there been a learning curve? I would say a little bit.
Starting to understand why these scores are so low. Look how tiny these goals are.
Those are practice goals, Coach.
He knocked that ball with his head. Is that legal?
Totally legal.
Hey, that's, wow, 3 points.
No points.
No points. Why not?
It's got to go in.
Come on, Rob. You got to get it in there to get 3 points.
1 point.
They got like an application for a phone I can learn the rules.
What are these trust exercises? Who's orange shoes there?
Gareth Bale.
That's Gareth Bale. Where he's from? He's from England?
Wales.
Wales. Wait, that's another country?
Yes and no.
How many countries are in this country?
Four.
But I'm learning, and I want to learn. These young men, they just would not understand exactly what I was trying to get them to do.
Guys, all I'm looking for is 60% effort, 4,000% of the time. That's it, skip. Skip like little girls. Go not a care in the world. I'm lucky to be doing this for a living. Everybody just do the robot.
You gotta ride a few players a little bit harder than some of the other players.
Blondie, you are killing me.
John, what do you got on there pants-wise? What is those?
Three quarters. And I get those in the women's section, John? Pick up the ball with your hands. That is a violation.
In an act of solidarity, I spent an entire day not using my hands out of respect towards the game. And I think that went pretty well. I think it garnered a lot of respect from the players. They appreciated not only the fact that I could do most activities without the use of my hands, but that I just tried. After a few days of practice, players gave me a nickname. It started small, but now they'll chant it at me every now and then. That's pretty nice.
What's the nickname?
Wanker.
Do you know what it means?
I think it just means great. Like, just like a nice guy, like, you know, kind heart, you know. Someone that listens, someone that'll push you. A wanker is someone that doesn't mind being alone, you know, likes to sit with his thoughts. Well, with any new job, you gotta anticipate a learning curve. But I tell you what, I'm in Tottenham, and I'm here to stay. You can guarantee that. 1 second here. Oh, nope, I got fired.
Premier League is on NBC and the NBC Sports Network, live on TV, online, or on the go.
Is there a third kind of football maybe I could look into?